Hey, what is going on, guys? In this video today, we're gonna be going over 5 tricks that I learned from watching the top console Fortnite players over the weekend. As you guys may be aware, a few days ago, we had the first week of the console duos FNCS. I thought it was really fun to watch, and I definitely learned a lot of interesting information that applies specifically to console Fortnite. I think these tips will be most helpful for competitive games such as Arena Mode or Scrims, but even if you're somebody that just plays pubs, I guarantee you, you'll still learn something from this video. So without further ado, let's get right into it. Alright, so the first really interesting thing that I learned from watching these top console players play is that in the current meta, high ground is absolutely dominant. And when I say that, I'm not just talking about high ground in moving zone endgames. Don't get me wrong, that's definitely a part of it. In a typical 3-5 teams left situation in an endgame, high ground is gonna win the vast majority of the time. You just have so much vision and so many available angles on everybody below you that it makes getting picks so easy. But I'm sure most of you guys already knew that high ground was preferred in endgames, but the point I'm trying to make here is that as of right now, high ground is preferred in almost every player versus player or team versus team fight. Even when box fighting and low ground was kinda meta back in Chapter 2 Season 1, since it's so difficult to edit really quickly on console, being on the defensive end of a box fight was still a situation I recommended avoiding whenever possible. But now, unless you have really good mechanics, being in a 1v1 with your opponent at your wall is basically a death sentence. And let me just list off some reasons of why that's the case. First off, there's a bunch of insane spray weapons like SMGs and miniguns that are great for spraying at walls and helping players phase through them. You also have a bunch of explosives in the game that are great for destroying 1v1s, you don't have any traps to defend yourself if the enemy gets inside your 1v1, and since shotguns are relatively weak, it's really hard to one-shot someone who phases into your box. But with high ground, there's just so much less stuff to worry about. Really, your only fear in most situations are explosives shooting you down and launch pads. There's no shockwave grenades, impulse grenades, rift-to-goes, balloons, I think you get the point. It always seemed like these console pros would opt for high ground when taking a 1v1 fight, and I think that says a lot about the viability of high ground versus low ground. The next observation I made when watching the console FNCS finals surprised me more than anything else on this list. Out of the 6-8 players that I was consistently watching, not a single one of them used an inventory spot on an SMG. Now, if you watch a lot of competitive PC players, that really isn't all that much out of the ordinary. A lot of these guys will basically use their AR as a bootleg SMG to have an extra inventory spot. However, on console, I didn't really expect to see that at all for 2 main reasons. First off, as I've mentioned before, we're in a very SMG-dominant meta right now, especially for controller players. The pump and the tac are both relatively weak, there are a bunch of really good SMGs in the game right now, and also, now that Legacy's gone, everybody's either on Linear or Expo, and both of those options have insane SMG tracking. Plus, on top of all that, SMGs are typically even more usable on console because it's a lot harder to hit shotgun shots on 60 FPS, so a spray-based SMG fits most players a lot better. And you think that these players would love SMGs, especially in a stacked competitive endgame, because the vast majority of fights always occur in those crazy moving zone situations where pretty much everything's happening at point-blank range. But that definitely wasn't the case at all, and because everybody was rolling around without an SMG, they all used the tac over the pump. And as we move on to the next thing I learned, I think it'll help us explain why everybody was willing to sacrifice their SMG for an extra inventory spot. Every single team that I watched would always have at least one player carrying explosives, and some teams would even have both players doing so. In solos, I didn't really see that very much. Sure, some players would carry around RPGs because they're really good in general, but I didn't see much C4 and almost nobody used nades. However, I believe the most obvious reason why that changed in this event is because it was duos, which is a team game mode. Explosives give you the option to make a lot of coordinated plays, such as double max distance nading a 1x1, RPGing and spraying a player, C4ing and wall replacing a player, the list goes on and on. And explosives are another one of those weapons slash items that I think gets a really nice boost on console because it doesn't require any kind of precise aiming. So if you're playing any kind of competitive team game mode, whether that be duos, trios, or squads, you're gonna have a total of at least 10 inventory spots between your team, and I think at the very least one of those spots should be occupied by an explosive weapon slash item. Not to mention the other viable miscellaneous options that I saw a lot, such as the heavy sniper and minigun. The next really interesting thing that watching these pro level console players taught me was the insane value of an uncontested landing spot. If you're playing any game mode in Fortnite and your end goal is to win, or maybe if it's arena, just survive until the end for placement points, I can't emphasize enough how important it is to find a landing spot where you'll rarely be contested at the beginning of the match. And I know that tip isn't really specific to console, but watching the FNCS console finals pretty much single-handedly changed my view on that topic. When I looked at the final leaderboard, I noticed that almost all the duos I watched that were in the top 5 to 10 had landing spots that were either uncontested every game or at least most of them. For example, Nut and Twexy placed first, they had Lazy Lake uncontested every single game. Jay-Z, Cracked, and Hollow got second and they had Retail Row uncontested. Cartoon and Lupian finished top 5 and they had Craggy Cliffs uncontested. Isaac and Apostle had the Islands Under Shark uncontested. I think you get the point. But then, when you take a look at the teams that fought over a town or a specific area on the map, the results were pretty brutal in general. One of the most disappointing duos of this FNCS Finals was 60FPS with a Dream and Blaza. They're considered one of the top 3-5 duos on console, and they only finished 28th out of 50 in finals, largely because of the fact that they got contested at their landing spot. Same deal with Wolfies and Leche on the controller on PC side of things. That duo is considered one of the absolute best in the world, and everybody thought they were an absolute lock to finish top 20 and qualify for grand finals, but they got contested at their landing spot by another duo, they experienced a bit of unfortunate luck, and it resulted in them finishing 31st out of 50. Incredibly disappointing. Those early game fights are just so RNG based that if your main goal is to win or get a lot of placement points, you're simply putting yourself at a major disadvantage by landing in a contested spot and taking spawn fights. And if you really want to understand how important an uncontested landing spot is, look no further than this tweet from Apostle where he says, "I don't think people understand. We already qualified going islands. Our main job now is to stormhold and grief every team that lands there from now on." This is a top 5 console duo on the planet, and they're willing to sacrifice hours of extra time and practice just to ensure nobody else that lands at their area qualifies for grand finals. And relating back to the importance of that uncontested landing spot, the final tip in this video is to have a predetermined loot path that expands outside the immediate area of where you land. This is something that a lot of players don't give nearly enough attention to. They'll land at a certain area of the map, loot that little area, and then just start rotating in some random direction that I guess they have a gut feeling about in their current game. And they'll feel like their job is now totally done when it comes to looting for that game. The top players, on the other hand, always have second, third, and maybe even fourth areas that they rotate to and loot in the early part of the match. Now, obviously, those secondary areas aren't going to be entire towns or anything. They're likely going to be smaller, outskirts buildings in random parts of the map, but it still adds up when it comes to improving their inventory. And a lot of the time, it isn't just about chests and floor loot spawns. These secondary looting areas may also be worthwhile because they have a lot of mats, or they're a good spot for fishing, which is still just as dominant as ever. So, I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and if you watched the entire thing, be sure to let me know with a comment down the comment section below. Simple question, did you watch any of the console duos FNCS Week 1 that took place over the weekend, yes or no? Be sure to leave a like, leave a comment, subscribe, turn on post notifications, do whatever the heck you want, and I will catch you guys next time.